gonna thank God for bringing you this far. You gotta thank God for bringing my man all the way. And you're all right. And you're all right. You gotta stand on your feet and run in the Lord.
Songwriter said, I won't complain. He said, I could, but I won't.
Hallelujah.
I thank God, amen,
amen,
that we have people that won't complain.
Amen.
The songwriter went on to say, he wipes all our tears away and turns our midnights into day. We won't complain. Truly thanking God, we give him praise, glory, and honor for all that he's done. Amen. Amen. Today you will have a journey with me as we go to 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter.
Amen.
Amen. Yes, when you have it, please say amen.
Amen.
Give it honor to the Spirit of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We give honor to Dr. Wimberly on this day, amen.
Amen.
And any other ministers that may be among us that we don't know of.
Amen.
Give honor to the officers of this church, deacon and deaconess and missionary.
Amen.
Amen. We give honor to those as well. Amen. And also I stop to pause and give honor to my wife,
amen.
First Lady Porter.
Amen.
If you're at 1 Corinthians 11 chapter, just say amen.
Amen.
Amen. And it reads as so. Now in this that I declare unto you, I praise you not, that you come together not for the better, but for the worse.
Yes.
For the first of all, when ye come together in the, what does it say?
Church.
So y'all see the word church in the Bible?
Yes.
When you hear people telling you that they the church, we don't need to come to church.
Mm-hmm.
There it is right there. Paul is talking to the members, and he said, for first of all, when ye come together in the
church.
Mm-hmm. So he's not talking about in you.
Nope.
He's talking about the church. He said, I heard that there had been division among you. Now, some of y'all who believe that you the church, and you probably do got some divisions among yourselves. You got about 4 or 5 people in there. And I partly believe it.
Uh-huh.
Paul was like me, a preacher, and he was talking to the congregation. That's what this is. It's a letter that he's writing to the congregation at Corinthians.
Amen.
They were at Coran. Okay? And so the book of 1 Corinthians was a book written to the Corinthians.
Amen.
And anybody know about Coran? It was a metropolitan city.
Yes.
It was like going to Brooklyn or going to Philadelphia or going to Washington, D.C. It was a real city with a lot of stuff going on.
Amen.
And Paul had been given the charge by God to go and set up many churches as the Spirit had given him utterance.
Amen.
And so here he was in Corinth, and these things were going on with the Lord's supper.
Amen.
Jesus had died, and he had had a last supper with this, with the members, the disciples. And now time had went by, and Paul was setting up churches and teaching them about what communion meant.
Yes.
And they were doing all kind. Oh, I meant to tell you, I'm done. Done with the reading. They were doing all kind of stuff. Y'all can sit down. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this opportunity. We ask you now to move us out the way. That we see nor hear none of ourselves, that all of you, God, you preach the word in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 So there was a lot of stuff going on in the churches. Not just in Corinth, but it was going on in Rome and in the Philadelphia, in the Philippians, just throughout the Asian community. And Paul had set up these churches, and he had to go and make sure, he was an apostle.
Yes.
He had to go and make sure that the churches was running in the right order.
Yes.
People don't believe that today there is an order in the church.
Yes, yes.
You can't just come into God's house and just do what you want to do.
Amen.
And as a pastor and as pastors that are out there, we got a charge by God to hold the church to a certain standard.
Amen.
My judgment will be totally different from yours.
Yes.
Okay? Much given, much required. You know, my job is to make sure that you guys are walking worthy in the calling that we have been called.
Amen.
My job is I'm a shepherd. Y'all are sheep.
Amen.
It's a difference. That's why when I got the charge, they gave me a rod and a staff to remind me there are going to be times that you're going to have to use your rod to gather the people, and then you got to use your staff to fight off the wolves that are going to come in the church. That's why when I was a young pastor, I usually didn't understand why people will come and try to come against the church, because everybody came in the church. See, we don't have good, clear understanding of how the church work. You have folk that walk in the church and they look like you.
Amen.
They look like sheep.
Amen.
But they're really raven wolves in sheep clothing.
Amen.
And so Paul was trying to get me and other pastors that come along that God has set aside to preach the word, he was trying to tell us to be aware of wolves that were entering into the church.
Amen.
To devour the sheep.
Yes.
And he was trying to teach us that we got to be careful as pastors that we don't allow people to come into church and start changing.
Yes.
Amen.
Man, help me, they were preaching.
Amen.
And start trying to change the laws and what God has sanctioned and put in order for the church.
Amen.
Okay, God has a plan for his church. The altar is just not an altar. You know, there are things that belong on the altar that God has decreed should be there.
Amen.
The tabernacle.
Amen.
The books.
Yes.
You know, that they left those books in the church. They left them on the altar. The altar is a place. That's why y'all come down and you kneel before the altar, because the altar represents a holy place. It's where God's spirit is.
Amen.
And that's the law and the years of how the word of God and what he had taught Moses and what all these other prophets and priests had came before, because in the beginning when God dealt with man, there was no sanctuary.
Amen. Amen.
So he would give his word to the priests and the prophets, and they would go and they would tell the people what thus said the Lord. Moses didn't have no sanctuary. He had a tent. He would just put a tent up, and that tent was because he was traveling. And then he would gather the people and talk to them, but thus said the Lord. But what happened as time went on, people began to go far away. They got spread it out. Not like y'all in New Hampton or New Penus. They didn't have no cars and no airplanes to just fly you in, just get in your house. Imagine if you live in downtown New Penus. You know how long it'll take you to get to church? On foot. So Paul would have to send a word out. He would try to go and set up churches that were close by, that the pastor that was being steeled by God. That's why he would say, well, how then can you hear? Because people was just like y'all. They didn't change. They was out there on the streets and they were doing stuff. And you had the sinners and the unbelievers. You had the believers. But the people that was of God would know that we need to come to the sanctuary.
Amen.
And you need to come get a word. They call it the temple.
Amen.
You would come into the temple and the Sanhedrin council, people like Nicodemus and Caiaphas. These people were like me. They were doctor degrees and they were teaching the people what thus said the Lord.
Amen.
But they were scholars of the book of the word. There are people today that come to church, they know the Bible.
Yes. Amen.
They know it from cover to cover.
Amen.
And they feel like because they know the word, they are like the Pharisees. They follow the Bible to the letter, to the T. But they have no spirit.
That's
you know, it's people in the church today. They come to church. They know how the church work.
Yes.
They know how the church portal work.
Yes.
They've been in church so long that they know what the church portal look like.
Yes.
But God ain't concerned about people knowing what the church look like. It's more he concerned about how you look.
Amen.
What you look like.
Right.
to know, is there any spirit in you? Is anything dwelling down? That's why the Bible told us as pastors to look out among you. Mm-hmm. And see if you can find seven men. And the first thing he said, he didn't say seven men is well learned and knowledge that know the word. He said full of the spirit. He wants you to look out, pastor, and look out and see seven men full of spirit. So when y'all come to church on Sundays, and y'all come in here every week, and y'all ain't trying to grow, you just come in here and sitting, want the pastor to preach a word to encourage you, and you've been in the church for how many years? And ain't growed a lick. Right? You supposed to come into church and you supposed to grow that the pastor, I'm feel like preaching this morning, that the pastor should be able to look out.
Yes.
Now every Sunday, pastors should be looking out, looking at who's growing, who's paying their tithes, who's being faithful in the ministry, who's doing the things that God is asking to be done, and the Lord is telling the pastor to look out.
Amen.
You know, don't look out because they dressed the part. You know, because they wear a suit every Sunday, or they know how to get up and talk about how good God is. That's good. But God wants you to look at their lives and see, is they living what they saying? Is what they living backing up with what they saying? Y'all got to help me today. That's why a deacon, before they become a deacon, they supposed to walk for about a year, not for the pastor. They supposed to walk as deacons that y'all try to spot their life.
Amen.
Before they can even put on a deacon, a suit, anything about a deacon, they supposed to walk as a deacon.
Amen.
And they supposed to walk worthy before the people.
Amen.
And you supposed to be able to look, and then before we set them aside as a deacon, we put out a council board.
Amen.
In the church with y'all. Yes. And you supposed to say, you know, who in the church feel that this person is worthy to be a deacon?
Amen.
Because some of y'all might have seen them at the drugstore. You know what the drugstore look like, right? What are you talking about, the drugstore? You know, you talking about they ain't getting milk or magnesia. They at the drugstore, they messing with Cavassier and Hennessy. You know, vodka. You know, stirred. Don't shake it, just stir. You know, they messing with that kind of stuff. So you supposed to be able to spot them. You put them there every now and then. Somebody gonna spot them. Be like, Pastor, I saw Deacon Elect. And see, you're not snitching. You're letting us know, Pastor, I don't think they're ready yet.
Amen.
See, because what we're supposed to be doing as members in the church, we want to make sure that what's inside the egg is cooked.
Amen.
Hard boiled.
Amen.
That means they have to go through something. That's why you send them out to the hospitals and they're supposed to go pray with the sick.
Yes.
See, but you know, today we got deacons and deaconess that they'll fudge you for a year, and then you by that third, fourth year, they want to sit, but they don't want the deacon part.
Okay.
Y'all ain't helping me today.
Yeah.
They'll sit, they want the minister, but they don't want the minister part.
Yeah.
You know, they don't feel like it's Sunday, I don't feel like going to the house and serve communion. Talking to my ministers.
Right.
Amen. My missionaries supposed to be out here on the road, they supposed to be going to people's houses, knocking on the door.
Yeah.
See, each one of them got a different role. Y'all don't know a deacon.
Yeah.
A deacon and deacon are supposed to be at the hospital going to visit the sick and shut in. A deacon and deacon that's supposed to support the pastor, they're supposed to have at least 10 families up under them that they should be calling every week to check on them.
Yeah.
Not check on them because they ain't come to church this Sunday. They should be checking on y'all every week to make sure that you are okay and that because you sheep. They helping the pastor. The missionary is supposed to be going out in the community, knocking on doors, trying to, they're missionaries. They're supposed to be inviting people to come to church. They're supposed to be like Jehovah's Witnesses, going around with their Bible, knocking on the door, seeing if there's some new people out here, going to 7-Eleven, putting flyers out, helping to build the ministry. Yeah, ain't helping you today. Then we're supposed to have elders in the church that they supposed to be helping the pastor, because pastor can't, you know, study the word, and then they come along to worship lead and to help pastor with and help the deacons.
Amen.
They help the deacons. If Deacon and Cedric had a problem and they wouldn't come right to the pastor, bring him all that.
Right.
Amen.
What good is our deacon if you got to keep taking everything to the pastor?
Amen.
Deacon is telling every time there's a problem, call the pastor. They telling y'all, call me. What do I need them for? Call pastor. My light bill due. They're not going to help you. They're going to tell you to call the pastor. No, they're supposed to be helping you. And if they can't help you, they'll go to the elder, the minister in the church, and tell them, sister or brother so-and-so got an issue. Y'all don't want to be knocking at my door. I just finished preaching. My door open. I can't even take my clothes off. I'm soaking wet because they're knocking on the door. Pastor, I get a ride to the job today. You really coming to me to ask me to get a ride? Can the van take me? You supposed to go to the deacon and deaconess. They supposed to be telling you, yeah, they got authority. They don't need pastor to tell me the van ain't pastor's. The van belongs to the church. So the deacon and deaconess have the authority. If it makes sense, tell them to drop you off. Yeah, you don't got to go to pastor with that. And if they can't figure it out, they need to go to Elder Wimley. And Elder Wimley should be able to give some type of authority to say, well, yeah, I'll get them. I'll take them. I will get them there. But one thing, this whole people in white,
amen.
They should not be hard-hearted, no compassion for the people. You know, why do they sit there and we sit out here?
Amen.
How come our clothes don't look like theirs? Because they have taken a charge, you know, not from pastor.
Right.
If you remember when the deacon stood here, y'all remember that day?
Amen.
And they had to take a charge?
Amen.
And they going to be faithful to the church and they going to help the pastor and all that. It was a beautiful night.
Yes.
Glorious night we had, ain't it? Oh man, they had cake and ice cream and sodas outside, and drink, punch. People came from out. The church was packed. But what folk got to understand, ministry is not what it all shaped up to be.
Amen.
Ministry is not about the glitter and the glory and the gleam.
Right.
Ministry is about, the Bible talks about ministry is work.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
He said whoever deserves a office as a bishop, he ought to be blameless.
Yes.
They don't have me here today.
Amen.
And then we go on to talk about deacons ought to be honest report.
Amen.
They supposed to have integrity.
Amen.
Right? They supposed to have full of the Spirit.
Amen.
One wife.
Amen.
Why do you think God put all that stuff in the Bible? Go to the book of Acts. You can read it. You'll see what a deacon ought to be. Y'all need to start holding these people accountable.
Amen.
Amen.
I don't have it here today. Y'all need to start holding these people accountable.
Amen.
Yeah. If you don't see the deaconess walking right, you need to go to the elder.
Amen.
Amen. And then if the elder ain't walking right, you need to come to the pastor.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Sometimes we get weary in wrongdoing.
Amen.
And if y'all ain't see me walking right, y'all got a right to go to Bishop Thomas.
Amen.
That's my pastor. See, there's nobody above God.
Amen.
And if Bishop Thomas ain't doing right, I can go to the Bishop Heber Brown.
Amen.
Yeah. See, there's order in the church.
Amen.
It ain't just you just come in here and just do whatever we want. No, there's a trustee ministry.
Amen.
These are people that we have set aside in an office to handle the money, the business of the church.
Amen.
That's what a trustee ministry do. They handle the business of the church.
Amen.
The money. They want to make sure that the lights are working and the stuff is going on. Y'all got a right to look at this. And you should be able to come to me and say, Pastor, you know, we got trustees, but they ain't, you know, the grass supposed to be cut.
Amen.
You know, the heat supposed to be on. They supposed to come down here throughout the week and check to make sure stuff right. The fire extinguishers.
Amen.
Stuff, y'all ain't hearing me. Y'all think all this stuff is on the pastor.
No,
it ain't on the pastor. That's why church members need to understand when something ain't going right. If there's a door locked out at the back and we can't get in, and because they said we ain't paying our rent, that first responsibility is to the trustee ministry.
Amen.
Okay, they ought to be keeping up with that stuff. They ought to be letting pastor know who paying their tithes, who paying their building fund. Why are we doing that? We just want to be nosy in all y'all business? No. It's like anything in life. If you are part of something, right? So how are you gonna come and ask the church because your lights get cut off at your house? Then we go to the trustee ministry. Trustee ministry look up and see they've been here for a year. Do they have a job? Yeah. Are they tied into the church? No. So then why are we going to give the church money?
That's right.
Go read the word of God. The Bible says that the pastor supposed to be a good steward.
Amen.
over the church business.
Amen. Right?
God is not having me to be ignorant over Satan's devices.
Amen.
If they out here spending their money and not paying tithes, when God told us in the word, if you ain't paying your tithes, he going to curse you.
Amen.
So why are we going to sit here and help you if God cursing you for not paying your tithes?
Amen.
No. Now, if you've done the things you're supposed to do and you out here going through, in the church supposed to be here for you because we are family.
Amen.
Now, you might go through some things, of course, and we find out that you found unworthy. We'll still help you.
Amen.
But we're not going to let you continue in this.
That's right.
We ain't up here today.
Amen.
We're not going to let you continue. See, I'm going to teach because I'm ready to get in this word, and I want to teach you what was happening then ain't too far for what's happening now. Okay, we thinking that the Bible, just the Bible. Paul was not teaching the Corinthians because they were wrong. There's nothing new under the sun.
Amen.
Paul was teaching the Corinthians and telling them in the word that these are the things that y'all are doing and y'all shouldn't be doing. But I mean, let me drop this bomb. They still doing it.
Amen.
They still doing it.
Amen.
Y'all notice how we have after church program when we feed people?
Yes.
Church packed.
Yes.
Okay, yes. Why is the church packed, Pastor? I'm going to tell you why the church packed. This is why the church packed. If you go to the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians, what we just read, and he said, now in this that I declare unto you, I praise ye not, that ye come together not for the better, but for the worse. He was simply saying, like, people come to our church. People deceive us and they have us to be ignorant of Satan's devices.
Amen.
See, they're not coming to glorify God. They're not coming to praise God. They're coming because it's something they want.
Amen.
Yeah, that'll be a day.
Amen.
The same people, the only time they come is when we cooking, are we doing something in the church. They're not giving the church nothing. They only come in because it's something the church doing that they want to take a part of. Paul said that they come in for the worse. But he went on to say in the 18th verse, for first of all, ye, when you come together in the church, I heard that that there be division among you, and partly I believe it. Now, when I read that, if before I read that, half y'all in the church didn't believe that it's going on in the church. Y'all don't believe in the church that people got aughts against one another? Y'all don't believe that, do you? You don't believe people come to church and some people in the church mad at the pastor? Now, that ain't the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen before in my life. How you going to be mad at the leader?
Amen.
Of the church.
Amen.
And mad, watch this, because y'all think Pastor's stupid. I'm far from dumb. I want y'all to know that. Take that back to where you got to take it. But I want you to understand something. The pastor's job is to correct.
Amen.
Y'all don't realize. I told you he gave me a rod and a staff. When I became bishop and they set me aside, I had to get a rod and a staff. The rod was to bring the folk together, but the staff was to keep the wolves out.
Right.
I tell people all the time, especially over here in East White, okay, if a pastor cannot correct you,
right,
as Mom would say, if you can't take the corrective criticism, you can't grow.
Amen.
Okay, if you go read the Bible about a deacon, they would tell you in there, they got to be out to teach.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. They got to be able to be corrected.
Amen.
Right? Because all of us, from me to the back door, we get in our flesh.
Amen.
Every last one of us.
Amen.
Right? But you guys got to understand something. My mom and dad got in their flesh.
Yes.
But as a child, I didn't have a right to speak against them.
Amen.
Y'all ain't got nothing here. The Bible said, honor your mother and father.
Yes.
For your day. He didn't say that if they right or wrong, you still got to honor them, because your honoring them is how your blessings come.
Amen.
You don't have the right to pick and choose and say, well, if they ain't talking, they don't treat me right, I ain't treating them right. That's where you as Christians in the church supposed to be able to look at other folk and find out if they are of Christ or not.
Amen.
Y'all ain't hearing me today. You should be able to find out. The Bible says, know them that labor among you. You should be able to look at one another in the church and realize if these people are of Christ or not. Because wolves enter to the church.
Amen.
When wolves come into church, they come in to kill, steal, and destroy.
Yes.
They can come to destroy the flow of the spirit.
Yes.
They can come to destroy the way if pastors preaching the word, when not to me, because wolves know me.
Yes.
They'll wait till they get away from me.
Amen.
And they'll get in y'all and they'll start dumping bad things. That's what they was doing in Korea.
Amen.
Okay, they had strife among them in the church.
Yes.
They had people in the church was talking against the leadership. They had people in the church that were talking against what Paul was doing. They were in there trying to bring division.
Amen.
Amongst the saints.
Amen.
That's why I keep telling y'all, you need to wake up.
Yeah.
You need to be alert, because a lot of folk are not alert. Yeah. They're walking around in the spirit, but they're not alert. I didn't even give y'all the subject for this morning, did I?
Yeah.
But let me give it to you. because it's going to help you. The subject is examining self.
Examining
self.
Amen.
I'm going to get to the communion.
Huh.
I'm setting it up. I ain't got a lot of time. I got enough time to do what I got to do. But I'm going to get to communion. Examining self is the subject.
Amen.
But what the people were doing in those days, right, they weren't examining self. Some like us in the church today, that's B100. We are examining others.
Yes.
We're coming to church, we're putting examination on other people.
Amen.
But the last person we're examining is ourselves.
Amen.
Stay with me. I'm in the Word. Just stay with
Amen.
Me. Because a lot of y'all, you and yourself right now.
Mm-hmm.
Go look in the Word. It says in verse 19, "For there must be also heresy among you,
Amen.
That they which are approved may be made manifest among you." Okay, so there were all types of strife and bickery and all this stuff that was going on in the church. Now you got to understand, when stuff go on in the church, that's where leaders come in to help the pastor fix the church. When Paul and when Peter and those in the book of Acts, when they went to set up the churches, the preachers were doing everything, the pastors, like they're doing today.
Uh-huh. Yep.
Like we're doing today.
Uh-huh.
And Paul was saying, Peter, they were saying, it's not good that we leave the word of God and go serve tables.
Yeah,
see, y'all reading the Bible, y'all don't understand the Bible. He won't talk about no tables like out there in the fellowship hall. He's talking about the tables where y'all.
Amen.
You know, I can't leave from learning my word to go and be a servant to the people.
Amen.
So he says, set aside some deacons.
Amen.
And deaconess came from deacons.
Amen.
Y'all gotta help me today.
Amen.
See, I know y'all living in the 20th century, 2024, amen, and y'all believe women is on the same level as men when it comes to deacons.
Yep.
I ain't seen nowhere in the Bible, but they talk about this lady named Phoebe,
yeah.
But a deacon, it was set aside. Go read your word, it said men.
Amen.
Seven men. Unless you think God made a mistake, he meant to call women men.
Ooh.
I don't think God, he ain't that slow.
No.
If that's the case, if he meant to call women men, when he told them to set aside deacons, and he called them men, then you can might say that maybe God don't know what he's talking about. So maybe he don't know what he's talking about when he said, let every man have one wife. So is he talking about a woman? Or is he talking about two men can get married?
Ooh.
Or two women can get married? Okay, so a deacon was set aside, and they looked down through the origin of history, and they said that it wasn't good for deacons, a man, like it ain't good for a preacher, a pastor, to be single.
Amen.
Right? Because the women come into church, and they want to date the pastor.
Yes.
He ain't married, he ain't got no wife, so all the women, you might have 25 women, I want to date him, right? They ain't coming to church to hear the word. They trying to look, he's got googly eyes. Right? Because I'm looking at the pastor, I ain't looking at the words, so I ain't learning nothing. I'm trying to be the next first lady. Okay, so when you have a first lady, that zeroed all that out, so we got to come get the word now. Right? He already got a first lady. We don't need two first ladies. We don't need one. So then you got men that became deacons, right? So the word was saying basically it's good for him to have a wife. That's why the word said for he become a deacon. Go read your Bible. It said he had to have one wife. That means he shouldn't be no deacon, sitting on the deacon board without a wife.
Amen.
Right? Because then he going around, he going to visit your house, right? And you single, and he's single, he a deacon, right? You want to be a deaconess, and you may have to perform acts to become a deaconess. So next thing you know, we try to find out how I sent you out to be a deacon, and then about a month from now, you got on a green suit, and she got on a green dress. And I'm like, and they walking in together. Like, what's going on with this? Well, Pastor, we've been wanting to tell you. For you that on a green dress, and you got on a green suit, y'all doing more than just liking each other. So what we just discovered is the deacon will probably fail.
Right.
And nobody says nothing in the church. We just let it go on and go on and go on. Nobody's saying nothing. So now we got adultery or fornication going on up here. And the white done turned red.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. if you're bleeding.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Right. So now the deacon losing interest in what his charge was for what he came to church for.
Amen.
He came here to serve.
Amen.
Right. So the Bible tells us that the deacon should be already married with a wife.
Amen.
Okay. But what I was trying to tell y'all, as a pastor, going back a little bit further, start looking out in the church, pastors today are supposed to be looking out in the congregation. Okay, you come to church, you might have came here one way.
Uh-huh.
You might have came here with this issue, but how are you going to be able to determine if you're growing?
Amen.
Right? Is you start dropping stuff off. You came in here married, your family's, it's hard for you to be in church, your husband at home,
uh-huh.
and you at the church.
Oh.
Okay? You should be praying to God bring the family together.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. See, you worrying about God deliver me.
Amen.
God is saying, if I deliver you and your husband's still out there, then you still gonna have strife.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. See, some of y'all got to understand the fundamentals of Christianity. You in here thinking, as long as I go to church to give God glory, but God wants your house to be in order.
Amen.
Can't help you here today.
Amen.
See, before you can come set up here, people need to, first of all, get the house in order.
Amen.
That's the problem in the church. A lot of folks run up here because they want the glamour and the glitter, and they don't have their house in order. A lot of people bypass this.
Right.
Now, y'all gonna help me in a minute. They don't left from being. They don't want to be a deacon. They want to go straight up here.
Oh.
I don't want to be a minister or nothing. I want to be a pastor.
Amen.
So I done went from a lay member to being a pastor because I can pastor just like him.
Amen.
I'm gonna get me a storefront church. I'm gonna be, and they out here tearing churches up,
yes.
tearing it up because they couldn't wait. And first of all, the Bible never told a lay member to leave from where you are to become a pastor.
Amen.
He told a pastor to look out among you.
Amen.
Okay? He supposed to look out among you. You should come through the ranks. You should first come from being a lay member to becoming a deacon.
Amen.
Uh-huh. I know people out there going to hear me tomorrow, next Sunday. They're going to be mad.
Amen.
What are you talking about? Yeah, I know people out here just lying on God, deceiving God. God called me. God does everything in decency and order.
Amen.
Okay, when God called me, he called me from to just be a lay member. I was sitting in the church. I had to learn. But so many people so inspired or lustful, they can't sit and learn. They're trying to hurry up and be a pastor. Okay? They don't got time to take the time to go through the ropes like they're supposed to. Because if pastor seen something in you, God's going to speak to the pastor and say, you know what? You need to be a deacon.
Amen.
Right? But the pastor needs to slow down that he don't make a deacon and he ain't walking worthy.
Amen.
But if he's walking worthy, this should be the first place you need to come.
Amen.
When I went to my pastor, I'd give you his name, Bishop Cutler.
Amen.
And I was a lay member. I said, the Lord called me in the ministry. I'm not saying God don't call people in the ministry, because God called me in the ministry as a lay member.
Yes.
But I thank God today that Bishop Cutler was my pastor and God had worked on him and he was seasoned.
Amen.
He took me and said, I was in his office. He said, God called you in the ministry? I said, yes, sir. He said, that's good. He grabbed me by the hand and said, come on with me. And they was up, it was a Saturday morning. They was up. We had went to prayer with Bishop Ruffin, and we was praying on a Saturday, and he was in his office, and I came on over to the office. I said, God, call me a minister. I'll never forget it. And the deacons were having a deacon board meeting. He curved me right over there to the deacons.
Right.
And he said, hey, chairman? He said, yes, sir. He said, Bro Porter here, that's what he called me, Bro Porter, not deacon, not minister. Bro Porter is saying that God is calling him into a spiritual walk. He said, I see things in him. I was married, I had a wife. So he told me to go on over to the deacon board. I sat on the deacon board the whole time. All of a sudden, I was stooging. He called me. See, I won't even learn.
Right.
I ain't have no knowledge about church. I'm mad about something. I don't know what I'm talking about.
Uh-huh.
I learned it better by and by, but I'm sitting there the whole time they're talking. I ain't even paying attention. God ain't called me to be no deacon. I'm gonna be up there in the pulpit with them. I'm a minister.
Uh-huh.
And I'm sitting there the whole time, and I went to Bishop Cutler. I said, Bishop Cutler, you hear what I say? I said, God called me to ministry. He said, I hear what you say. That's why I'm putting you on the deacon board. He said, now what you need to do if you're going to be a minister, you first got to learn how to serve.
Amen.
This Bishop Cutler, this is my pastor, my first pastor who set me aside. He said, the first thing you need to do is learn how to serve. And he spent a year sending me to the hospitals, sending me to the old folk home.
Amen.
He sent me where he'll call me on the phone and say, not deacon, I was on a boy. I was a walking deacon. He said, Brother Porter,
uh-huh.
I need you to go up to the Eiffel Towers, and I need you to go visit Mother Leona, whatever. I'll go up there. He said, he would train me.
Yes.
When you get there, don't go in there doing a lot of talking.
Right.
He said, go up there and listen to what she has to say. She's about 80-some years old. Let her talk to you. Just stay there about 10, 15 minutes. Uh-huh. Pray. After you finish praying, he said, let her know that I send my love and the church loves her. And if she need anything, she might have been too old. She can't come out to church. Right. So he'll send me to go do some Bible study with her.
Amen.
15 minutes, read the word, encourage her in the spirit. Yeah. That's what church was.
Yeah.
That's when you got good training.
Amen.
Then I'd go back and I would bring a report to him.
Amen.
I ain't just going on home. I would call him on the phone, or I'd go back and say, Pastor, I went to Mother so-and-so, and I talked with her, and everything is going well. And he would be like, all right, Brother Porter, thank you. God bless you. I'll call you when I need you.
Uh-huh.
That's what walking deacons did. I'll call you when I need you.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Amen.
You didn't have no voice. You won't sit on the deacon board and tell people what you think we should do.
No.
Because you just a little snotty nose lads yourself. Anybody know anything about order? Somebody in Radio Land, next week they're going to get this truth.
Amen.
About a year later, I won't looking to be licensed, ordained to be a deacon. I just did the work.
Amen.
And when the bishop saw that I was doing the work and not trying to do it to become that,
Amen.
Doing it because he didn't tell me in a year we're going to set you aside.
That's right.
You didn't know when you're going to get set aside. You just worked.
Amen.
You just did whatever.
Yeah.
And he came back when he thought it was time. He said, Brother Porter, he'll tell me somewhere around 3-4 months, I'm going to set you aside as a deacon. I'm going to license you.
Mm-hmm.
And when he would do that, after he tell you to license me, he'll bring me in, right? And I went through a catechism.
Amen.
You didn't just walk from there to there. Mm-hmm. He gave me questions, and I had to go home and read them, and I had to study them, and then he set me in front of a board of people, and they drilled me questions about being a deacon.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
After I went through that, and he said, okay, you good. Then they had a service,
mm-hmm.
and I got set aside as a deacon.
Mm-hmm.
But before I sat in that chair, I had that uniform, I went through strenuous to make sure I was ready.
Amen.
And I thank God. You know why? Because down through the years, there was times in my life that I seen something, and I heard something, and I felt something. And if I didn't have that good foundation,
yes.
I ain't go to church and go to sleep.
Amen.
Deacons don't sleep in the church. Deacons wide awake. Deacon is saying, amen, Pastor.
Amen.
A deacon is trying to tell. A deacon was almost like a minister.
Amen.
A deacon is in the church like a minister because on any given day, the pastor should be able to turn to the deacon and say, I need you to preach today.
Amen.
You might didn't preach up there. You came and preached over here.
Right.
You got to know the word.
Yes.
You got to know how the word. You got to be praying and reading your scriptures and being involved in the church, because when pastor called you to come up, you're supposed to be ready to carry out a service.
Amen.
You're supposed to be a worship leader.
Amen.
You're supposed to be able to preach if need be.
Yes.
How you going to be a deacon if you can't preach or know the word? How you going to somebody's house and tell them, how am I going to encourage you in the word?
Amen. Amen.
I need somebody to hear me today.
Amen.
I'm trying to get y'all some order, but this is what was going on in Korea.
Amen.
I'm not up here just talking to hear myself talk. I'm in the Word of God.
Amen.
A lot of y'all come to church every Sunday and have no clue why you here or what's going on in here.
Amen.
That's why you get bored. You don't understand because you don't know what church order look like.
Amen.
Who goes to a job and reports to a job and don't know how the job runs?
Amen.
How you look like going to KFC and they put you at the window and they just put you there? Cars riding by. Hello, you in there? You hear me? I'm trying to order 2-piece. You on the thing? How are we supposed to do this? What is a 2-piece? People can tell when you don't have no training. You don't know what's going on.
Right.
Training is here.
Amen.
Okay, stay right there. I'm gonna show
Amen.
Y'all something. I ain't gonna be able to teach this like I want. We don't talk too much today. But listen to what I'm saying. I'm gonna get out of your way. I'm gonna try to understand something. Go to verse 20. When you come together, therefore, unto one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. Okay, if you read down a little further, for in eating, everyone takes before others his own supper, and one is hungry, and another is drunken. Back in those days, when they had communion, Not like we today, we're a little bit more modern, but in these days, I'm about to leave y'all alone, but in these days, in those days, everybody in the church will come to church and you'll bring your own dinner. You bought your own dinner.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
And when church was over with, y'all was gonna sit out there and everybody would eat. So you would be eating your dinner, and you would eat your dinner.
Dang.
And there were some among us that didn't have food, right? And we didn't care. Yeah, go read the scripture.
Yes.
There were some that was hungry, and the others didn't care. They just went on and ate their dinner.
Yes.
And so that's why Paul said, if you think, you know, they would cook a good meal and make it real nice, like we do here.
Amen.
I try to teach y'all in the church. I know I got to go. The enemy is on me. But when I bring y'all here like last Sunday, some of y'all don't get this. Y'all think y'all in church, but I'm trying to teach y'all basics.
Amen.
Last Sunday, when the people came for Easter, and we had cooked all that food, right?
Yeah.
We that are spiritual, we that are church members should learn that we set back. This stuff you learn at home.
Yeah.
You know, my mom would cook dinner and she would say, you know, if visitors came over and she ain't have a 12 rolls, I'm not going to eat four.
Right.
She would tell me before they come, now Johnny, you know we don't have that much. I didn't make that many rolls, so make sure to guess.
Yes.
Some of y'all sitting in the church, y'all don't have no home training, no spiritual training, no nothing.
Amen.
You know, you supposed to set back because you're a member.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
That's what they want doing communion.
Right.
You know, instead of you bringing your food and sharing it with those who didn't have, the visitors came to our church, we supposed to break bread and share it.
Amen.
We supposed to look for those in the church who don't have and share what we have with others.
Amen.
Okay?
Amen.
We ain't doing that today.
Yeah.
Okay? I'm talking about the basics, foundation of spirituality.
Amen.
We come to church and we are not sharing anything with anybody.
Amen.
I want y'all to see that today.
Amen.
That's what's happening in the church. I'm not talking about food. I'm talking about anything. We're not sharing love.
Right.
We're not sharing compassion.
Amen.
We're not sharing, you know, church is not in here.
Right.
Amen.
I'm about to leave y'all alone. I got to go. Church is not what you do in the sanctuary. Church is mostly what you do outside of church. This is where the enemy have got people all mixed up because the enemy got folk believing you ain't got to go to church, you the church. No, the Bible's trying to tell us, yes, we are the church because he's saying we're supposed to be the example of what a church look like. Right? That means when people come to the church and they are in help, he told us to be helpers one to another. He don't want you to come to church, become a member of the church, and then you all the time, you always got your hand out. You're a beggar.
Right. Huh.
You put to be coming to church, bringing your tithes, become a partaker of what's going on, and God is telling you, then I'm going to bless you.
Amen.
See, people looking for their blessings to come. They want God to bless, but they still live in a mess.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. You ain't going to help me today.
Amen.
Yeah, people thinking that they're going to be able to, you know, it's too high.
Right.
You can't get over it. I'm talking about God. He's too low.
Amen.
He's too wide.
Right.
I don't know why we think, because what worked for you in the world don't work for you in kingdom building.
Amen.
You, God is the creator. He saw you in darkness.
Yeah.
He brought you to the marvelous light.
Amen.
But if you was a trickster in the world,
yeah,
tricks that don't work with God.
Amen.
Whatever you
Amen.
Was in the world,
Amen.
That's how you know if you've been changed.
Because
the things I used to do,
Amen.
I don't do them no more.
Amen.
You got folk coming to church and they still in the club.
Amen.
They got one foot in the church and the other foot in the club.
Amen.
And they saying, God understand. No. See, what God is trying to tell you, you got one foot in the church, you got the other foot in the club. He's saying, I'd rather you be hot or cold. You know, he's saying you can't straddle the fence. Either, you know, if you're in the club, you ain't got to. See, you can't be straddling the fence if you've been changed.
Amen.
I'm not talking about you change you.
Right.
Once any man be in Christ,
yes,
not once any man get himself together and come to Christ,
right,
but once any man be in Christ,
right,
he's a new creature.
Amen.
How we can tell that we knew? It's not because you figured this thing out.
Amen.
You knew because God touched you.
Amen.
The only person that can really change you from who you used to be. The only person that can destroy the old man and bring the new man to life is Christ. You can't do it. You can't come to church. But here's what you can do. Here's what you can do. If you're sitting here like, well, God ain't saved you yet, I'm still waiting. He told you, he said, those who hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. God is saying, if you really want this, you got to put forth some effort. If you really want it, you need to be coming to church every Sunday. You need to be seeking after God. You need to be showing God that, I hear you, Pastor, but what you saying, he ain't talking to me. You know, I heard pastors say the Lord speaks to him. He ain't talking to me, right? But if you want God to talk to you, then you have to seek him. Man, help me here today. Y'all ain't really heard me today. You got to seek him. How do I seek him, Pastor? Seek him in your prayers. Seek him in your walk every day. You can't come to church and live like a demon or hell raiser for 6 days, come in here on Sunday morning for 2 hours and fake the funk.
That's right.
And some people say, I'm going to fake it until I make it. I don't think you're going to ever make it. Because ain't nothing with God fake.
Amen.
Everything with God is real. Everything with God is true.
Amen.
God wants you to worship him in spirit and in truth.
Amen.
If you are drunk, you can worship him, but let him know, God, forgive me, I'm still a drunk.
Amen.
But my tongue speaks the truth.
Amen.
My tongue don't speak a lie.
Amen.
God don't want you to come to church and put some stuff in your mouth, put on the right clothes, fix yourself up. Inside, I'm still a drunk, but I'm telling people I'm saved, sanctified, and filled.
Uh-huh.
No, he'd rather you be truthful.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Stop trying to please the world and start trying to please God.
Amen.
Folk coming in here talking all this, God, but your life don't line up with nothing you say.
Right.
I told y'all about the brown roach on the white wall.
Amen.
You think that you fooling everybody. And I'm sitting here looking at you as a pastor, and I'm like, you know, silly rabbit tricks are for kids.
Amen.
It ain't fooling nobody, because I can look at your lifestyle, the things that's coming out, the things that's being said, what you're seeing. The Bible says that know them. Because ain't nothing most of us in here doing that other folk ain't done.
Amen.
People might play stupid like we don't know what's going on. Folk be like, man, come on, bro, I done seen that. Ain't nothing new.
None.
Amen. I can't speak for the people over here,
Amen.
But I can speak for me. When I first became in the ministry and God called me, I went through some struggles.
Amen.
I had some good days. I cried a lot because I was fighting my old man.
Mm-hmm.
I was trying my best. And I read somewhere where Paul said, but when I would do good.
Yes.
I didn't understand until I read it. Your age, young man, striving my best, trying to do my best. Everybody coming up against me. People that didn't understand me because I wasn't where they wanted me to be, then I was misunderstood.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, oh, you ain't saved. You doing this. And I'm like, God, I know I'm doing the best I can. Why do I keep falling short of your glory?
Mm-hmm.
Then I read somewhere in the Bible, but Paul said, but when I would do good. I began to cry because I said, somebody understands that I'm trying my best to do good, but this evilness, just because I left the world don't mean the world don't want to leave me.
Amen.
And there's times in your life, okay, I saved, sanctified, Holy Ghost filled you are, the world still keep calling your name. Johnny, come back and play.
Amen.
And if you're not spiritually prayed up, spiritually in the Lord, spiritually reading your word. I ain't talking about playing church. I'm not talking about coming here on Sunday acting like you into it. I'm talking about if you ain't cracked your Bible all week, then you know, no prayer, no power.
Amen.
If you ain't praying, reading your word, coming to church, seeking God, there's no way you gonna go for 2 hours of church and then come back 2 hours next Sunday and you prayed up.
Amen.
You got to be in your word. You got to be praying. This is a fight.
Yes.
Paul said, I fought a good fight.
Amen.
This is a fight. We fighting.
Yes.
But everybody ain't fighting a good fight. Some people just fighting.
Amen.
You might be fighting on the wrong side.
Amen.
If you ain't careful.
Amen.
Amen.
God wants us to understand people.
Yes.
He wants us to understand self-examination.
Amen.
Examine yourself.
Amen.
First Sunday, I'm going to leave y'all alone. It's first Sunday.
Amen.
Right? First Sunday is God's opportunity to tell you while you're sitting in that chair today that I need you to really examine yourself. I don't care if you're the worst
desperado in the church. You're the worst criminal. But what God is saying, be real with yourself.
Amen.
At the end of the day, you can fool some of the people, some of the time. You can fool all of the people, all the time. But there's two people you definitely can't fool.
Amen.
God and self. Because at the end of the day, you know who you are. Yes,
that's
you
right.
do.
Amen.
You know if you ain't living right. And it don't make no sense for you to come in here and try to make everybody think you are
Amen.
When you know you're not.
Amen.
You need to sit back, look in the mirror, and start being real with yourself because hell is real.
Amen.
And the devil wants you to do nothing more than deceive yourself.
Amen.
Check up out of here. Because the Bible says what, y'all? There is a way
yes.
that seem right unto man,
yes.
but the end
yes.
is going to lead you to destruction. What do you think that destruction is? That's hell. That's you lived a life all week. God is saying to you, put forth your best effort. You know, may the work that I've done speak for me. Sometimes it seemed like nothing at all. But when I stand before my God, I want to hear him say, well done. Well done to. That's what it is about parents. That's what it is about parents. If you're a parent, you got more than one child. A parent knows their children. Just like God knows us. A parent knows. If you got a child that's got a PhD and they making six figures and they living a good life, and then you got another child that didn't do good in school. Maybe they just didn't have the brain that child had in it. And they struggle. And they living in the projects. And they eating pork and beans out of a can. Mm. That parent don't love this child any more than they love that one.
Right.
You need to know your God.
Amen.
God does not love you because you telling people, I'm making him think you perfect. See me, God, in my
Amen.
Realness.
Amen.
He loves you when you can stand before him naked.
Amen.
And you can let him know, God, you know me already.
Yes.
You know my faults. You know my shortcomings. You know God. You know who I am.
Yes. Yes.
But if you will just help me,
yeah.
he said, if you come for strength, I'll keep you.
Yeah.
God wants you to just come real to him.
Yeah.
Just be real. Just be naked.
Yeah.
Let him know your thoughts. He already know them. You might as well be real with him.
Yeah.
God, I don't like my husband.
Well,
he gets on my nerves, but I need you to help my unbelief.
Amen.
Whatever your plan is for me, you let me know.
Amen.
Fix me, Jesus.
Amen.
Fix me like you said you would.
Amen.
But if you want to keep playing Sunday church, you want to keep coming here, going back out the same way you came, then so be it.
Amen.
But if you really, really, really want to take communion and you want to be real with yourself,
yes.
God don't want you to be perfect because you're never going to be perfect.
Amen.
But he wants you to measure up to who you are.
Amen.
If this is all I am, God, then here I am, Lord.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
I believe the reason why God saved me because when I was lost, I was real. I was like, God, I know who I am. I'm a sinner. And I know that I wasn't worth nothing. Even when I was out there. But I wasn't going to play God. I wasn't going to play church. God would rather you come up here and take communion with a sincere heart. Even if you're jacked up. But you should walk away from here with the right spirit saying, God, I know I'm not worthy to come take communion. But I promise you, God, just give me a chance. I'm going to do better.
Amen.
I'm going to do better.
Yes.
Nobody goes into debt and comes out the next week.
Amen.
When people go into debt, you got to work on your credit.
Yes.
You got to pay bills on time.
Yes.
You got to do things to get your credit right.
That's right.
But so it is with God.
Amen.
You got to do things, people, to get your credit right with God.
Amen.
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 Yes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Some of y'all are living beyond your credit.
Yes.
That's why you can't go to him and ask and you ain't receiving nothing.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. Amen.
Writing bounce checks.
Whoa.
I don't mean bounce checks in the flesh.
Right.
Bounce checks in the spirit.
Amen.
You praying a prayer that ain't reaching God.
Amen.
Because you want God to do stuff but you don't want to change.
Amen.
You want God to do stuff but you don't want to get rid of the stuff you're doing that God ain't pleased with.
Amen.
But you want to stand before him and God, I don't understand, you know, I'm praying, I'm going to stop going to church because God ain't answering my prayers. He ain't answering your prayers because you ain't doing what he asked you to do.
Amen.
Amen.
He ain't answering your prayers, but are you doing what you're supposed to?
Come on.
Huh? You living in financial crisis, but won't tithe.
Amen.
See, y'all don't hear that. So you want God to become a liar. He done told you in the word, if you don't tithe, I'm going to curse you. So you're going to stand here and think that you're not going to tithe, and he going to still bless you. That makes him a liar. God can't do that. Then you get mad because God won't bless you, and everybody else around you being blessed, and you don't want to take time to find out, how are you blessed? What's going on in your life? And they tell you, I pay my tithes. I do what God asks me to do. And that's why he keeps blessing me.
Amen.
The Bible said, when you come to the knowledge of the truth, walk therein.
Amen.
When you come to the knowledge of the truth, the day you hear my voice, harden not your heart, and come to Jesus just as you are. He's not telling you to come to church dressed the way you are. He's telling you to come to him spiritually as you are.
Amen.
If you're broken down, if you're defeated, come.
Amen.
And I'll restore you.
Amen.
If you're a cheater, come.
Yes.
And I will redeem you.
Yes.
If you're a liar, come.
Yes.
And I'll give you a tongue to speak the truth.
Amen.
But you got to come to God. And you got to come with the right spirit.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Pastor Dunn.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Y'all ready to go on anyway. Y'all ready to go. Y'all ain't even listening. Y'all ain't even paying me no attention. That's what I'm talking about. And then you walk up out of here and you go live this week just like you lived last. Nothing's changed. Nothing's different. The same old, same old. And you're battling with yourself trying to figure out why nothing in my life changing. Why, how come Romeo ain't came? See how y'all think Pastor playing? The Bible says that if you would live upright unto God, he said, I will hold. Here you go. You're making him, you're trying to make him a liar. He said, I will hold no good things from you.
Amen.
I will give you the desires. See, some of y'all don't think God's a liar because you won't prove him.
Amen.
Prove him.
Yes.
God knows your mate.
Amen.
He know your mate. Some of y'all done lived the lie so long, you don't even want a mate. That's sad. You in your prime. I don't want no man. I'm good. What kind of mess is that?
I don't know either.
It don't sound natural. The Bible says it's not good for man to be alone.
Amen.
That's why he created woman, for you can go and find your mate.
Amen.
You should be saying, Lord, where is my Romeo? You said the man won't good to be alone. He coming to find his woman.
Amen.
I've been standing at the dock of the bay. Walk at the time,
roll away.
I'm at the dock of the bay. Some of y'all young ladies here, I'm looking at y'all. Y'all young and y'all prime.
Yeah.
And you telling me that God wants you to be without a man? You young. Now I can see if we got some of our other sisters in here. Talking about sisters this morning. We're talking about the what we talking about this morning, my deacons. You said the heat flashes. Yeah, some of y'all done lived your life three and four times over, but some of these young women, y'all young, and y'all done gave up on life. Sad. I ain't even home. I was talking to a young lady this week, just past Monday. I was talking to her. Me and her was talking. This young lady ain't about probably her 28.
Uh-oh.
And me and her talking, and I said, you ain't got no man, no husband. Oh, shoot, I don't want no man. I'm good. I'm married to God. I said, huh? She said she married to God at 28. I said, so when you get tired of being married to God and you want a man, you about 60. What man gonna want to come try to get with you at 60? I said, you ain't even 30 years old and you done gave up on men? Pastor, hey, man, out here today. I'm like, okay, so you don't think that God is steady, you don't think that God has your mate, whom God put together, let no man. God, for everybody, me and First Lady, I stay walking through the store, and I'm gone, I promise y'all, I'm gone. Me and First Lady walking through the store today, she saw this young guy, I ain't gonna tell you what she said, but he was with his woman, and she like, John, for everybody is somebody. For everybody. woman to somebody. She was trying to let me know if this guy here can get a woman. Ain't no way that these other bright, intelligent young men out here.
Amen.
Yeah, I'm gone. I'm gone. I'm leaving y'all alone. I'm gone. I'm gone. I'm gone. I promise y'all. Y'all bring the table out. I'm gone. I'm funny. I'm gone.